Good evening. I'm Robert Polito, director of the New School Graduate Writing Program, and it's my immense pleasure to welcome you to this evening of poetry with Cave Canem. I want to thank all of our friends at Cave Canem, particularly Allison Myers and Camille Reagan, and I'd like to welcome our new friend, Hafiza Dieter from Cave Canem. This is our first poetry reading of the year, and beyond friendship and personal affiliations, I think the New School shares with Cave Canem a progressive vision of readings that are focused on craft and art and the history of the form. So it's absolutely perfect that this is our first reading of the year. So please join me now in welcoming Hafiza Dieter, who will take on the rest of the evening. Hafiza.
Hello, good evening, and welcome. I'm Hafiza Dieter, and I'm the Bloomberg Philanthropies Program Intern at Cave Canem. For those of you who are unfamiliar with us, Cave Canem is a national organization dedicated to cultivating the artistic and professional growth of African-American poets. Since 1996, Cave Canem has been building a home for Black poetry and many sites across the country. We have a lot of great programs throughout the year, including Cave Canem at Word for Word, which happens on September 6th at 12:30 p.m. at the Bryant Park Reading Room, located at 42nd Street between 5th and 6th Avenues, and featuring Cave Canem poets Erica Campbell, Sharon Dennis Wyeth, and Reginald Harris. Also, please check out the table in the back, where you can sign up for our mailing list to receive updates, as well as find out about upcoming Cave Canem events, such as Cave Canem at the Brooklyn Book Festival on September 18th, Cave Canem at the Dumbo Arts Festival from September 23rd to the 25th, our second annual benefit on October 24th, as well as our many other events. You can also learn more about us, what we're up to, and ways to support Cave Canem on our website at cavecanempoets.org. I'd also like to thank our hosts and co-sponsors, the New School for General Studies, especially Robert Polito and Lori Lynn Turner of the New School Writing Program. Thanks also to our funders, the Greenwell Foundation, the New York State Council on the Arts, the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, the New York Community Trust, Lila Atchison Wallace Fund for the Arts, and the New School for General Studies. And I would also, of course, like to thank all of you guys for coming. So thank you for coming. Tonight, we're excited to present Cave Canem Fellows Read at the New School, featuring Cave Canem poets Duriel Harris, Ayodele Heath, and Khadijah Queen. Duriel Harris is the author of Amnesiac from Sheep Meadow Press, 2010, and called Wildly Thrillingly Experimental by Nick Flynn, and Drag from Elixir Press, 2003. A poet, performer, sound artist, and scholar, Duriel holds degrees from Yale University and the Graduate Writing Program at New York University, and a PhD from the University of Illinois. She's been awarded grants from the Illinois Arts Council and postdoctoral residencies at the University of Illinois Chicago and the University of California, Santa Barbara. Ayodele Heath is the author of Brick Road Poetry Press's latest collection, Otherness, 2011, described by Thomas Lux as both fierce and tender. Creative Loafing describes this native Atlantan performance poet as a lanky African-American man with arms that stretch and reach as the stories unfold. Hopefully we'll get to see that. Ayodele has been featured at venues such as the National Black Arts Festival, the Turner Trumpet Awards, and TurnerSouth's MySouth Speaks television campaign. Khadijah Queen is the author of Conduit from Black Goat Akashic Books, 2008. Of Conduit, Claudia Rankine calls its stunning meditations a current that runs through a historical and mythical past, called up out of the soil and already belonging to us. Khadijah's individual poems have been three times nominated for the Pushcart Prize and appear widely in anthologies and journals, such as Best American Nonrequired Reading, Jubilat, Tuesday, an Art Project, and 1111. Her second collection, Black Peculiar, won the 2010 Noemi Book Award for Poetry and is published by Noemi Press. Duriel, would you like to kick us off? Thank you. Everyone, welcome Duriel.
Good evening. I want to thank everybody for being here. I want to thank Allison and Camille and Khadijah. I want to thank, of course, Toy and Cornelius and Carolyn as well. And I want to thank Robert Polito. Haven't seen you in a while. It's good to see you again. Thanks, everybody, for coming. I'm going to read some poems from Amnesiac and some new work. Unfurled. The pain body speaks in repose. Where there is will, apathy, and subjection, I am a faithful servant gone to market. Gradually, purity, the blood idea, will soften the contour of each living man, drawing out the will to power to command enormity, vagrant and enwrapped, a body sorely knit like mine, a mighty swirling column of refuse and scraps. To see after it and see to it, I am. That I am, I cater annihilation. I will break your restless walking to flickers and taps. Burrowing, I torment dreams and waking fears, clear wind and notches of smoke. I scrounge and make do, scuttle and mangle and roam to make barren. Seeking, I find. The inflammable ligature, the human thread, and use it as fuel. Yet, who can but come to table at the invitation of a feast? Charity compels labor, and conscience begs no pardon. Traversing the earth, I whistle and build, chisel and chur, amassing roving death dealers, porous ghosts, and memories of the bewildered dead's pathetic squealing. I nurse hatreds to dress hatreds. Marshal squadrons of dogs, locusts, and carrion birds, and send them forth with poignant clarity. They shall run and not be weary. Oh, drunken momentum, oh, sun-baked splatter, insatiate, they too shall devour. Come and celebrate with me this triumphant living sin. In praise of its stench, low and spiraling downward, hawkish whir, nexus of the eye, fallen to seed the ground. In praise of its deep structure, and obscenity, its flesh wager and decomposition, wilding, wagging into subtle architecture, fingers, isolated joints, remnants of suppurating wounds. In praise of its bald-faced supplicants, coaxing the unseen with jars of jaw fragments and teeth, hair, and scalp wrapped in brown butcher paper, and trinkets. Obstinate vertebrae brushed a metallic blue. The bony burr of hatchet holes and skulls in rows like shoes for sale. A note on the text. The pain body, as conceived by Eckhart Tolle, is accumulated pain that occupies the body and mind. It is described as a ravenous, parasitic entity that feeds on and seeks out pain. I'd also like to read Amnesty. As ritual utterance and rumination upon emergence into a next world, amnesty is modeled after English translations of select passages of the Egyptian Book of the Dead, also known as the Book of Going Forth by Day. It's also important for you to know that during the Rwandan genocide, extremist Hutus referred to Tutsi survivors as those not finished off. Amnesty. Those not finished off have arisen and walk with the dead, twisting their mouths and skin. Those not finished off have arisen and walk with the dead, grinding their sleep. Throw open the embalming chamber, its inhabitants have gone out to shovel the day. Throw open the factory, the churches, the school. A plague has blown shadows through their songs. What is it? What does it mean? What quarrel, what seizure, what scourge? The dead bring forth from night. The dead bring forth from night, hacking earth with blood and broad, flat plate. Self-portrait as Negro girl. The desire to belong extracts what no one knows remains, leaving enough to make eloquent my polite decay. Self-portrait at the millennium. For Mamie Till Mobley. Has a bass line. Kind of goes like boom, boom, a boom, 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 a boom, boom, ba boom, boom. Bad medicine stalks its way to surface, catches like dirt latched blades, barbed buoy, bloated blood house. Tendered skull, hole punched to daylight. Minced cartilage toughens the brilliant chill until hours protrude, hard and slick. Bad medicine stalks its way to surface. It is like dirt lashed blades, barbed buoy, bloated blood house. Tendered skull. Punch to daylight. Means Norland's thumb in the bridge. Ours. Truth. Hard and sleep. Spoiled Negra is the meat. Its hearty pulp warms hands, builds strong bones and teeth. Spoiled Negra is the meat. Its hearty pulp warms hands, builds strong bones and teeth. spoiled nigra is the meat. Its hearty pulp warms hands, builds strong bones.
Okay. I'd like to read a couple of newer pieces. How they carried their hands past pounding for Jeffrey Renard Allen. What business had a nigga there? Doors hiss closed, washing a metal sounds tight flesh, slickness beating in the joints, oily fat and skin pinched past the grimace. What? Spittle damp, reclining in velvet cushions, smoky blue grease, suspended above a glass pipe's bowl, blowing a thin suck of air into a waiting mouth, a steel cabinet's open, slanted drawer. What business? Cork hiding in the woodpile, floating, bludgeoned in the creek. A nigger, dangling, seed on a string, a kite to fly or drag. Cud white meat of a knot snatched and jerking. There, wrapped in newspaper, folded in rough linen, wound in jute, bound in plastic and sealed, packed in wood crates, coolers, bins, cans and barrels, freight boxes, cartons, cedar chests, trunks and footlockers, burlap and gunny sacks, canvas satchels, rubber totes, buckets, sequined clutches, steadied in wrought iron frames, stitched into tapestries and war rugs, twisting the latch hook fringes, born in baskets, jugs, glass and clay, potter's jars, urns, vaults and barrels, piled onto tarpaulin beds, into cabs, caravans and carts, perched in paper cages, pulled soaking in vats, pickled in tight milky bottles, hung on cables by the wrist hollows, joined in webs of extremities, clasped and flat against human feet and quartered hinds, bolted, clamped onto cylinders, juggled loose in their hands. There, peeling back the blackening crisp fins, skyward thumbs, sipping the surly primus, spun out and worshipped like a sun. Jaundiced eye, pinned open, spilling tentacles, light cleaved shadows, the blue scuttle swiftness parting against the swell, slaughter pulling back red sleeves of circular muscle, clicking tracks through a black water gaze, teeth flitting against the gate. Before this dream, there's a blue dress, a tangle of trees, and the distance between voices. There is routine sorting of like things, bank statements, unopened letters, photographs turned inward from the damp. There are cows in clusters, truck stops, cinder block churches, scattered tractors, and fields cleared and flooded. Before this dream, there's a scored tablet, a ream of paper, a child's face swollen from abscess, shining like a good beatdown. And there is another dream. In it, a building juts forth like a missile. It is a windowless octagon sided in cork. I am strapped to it. A man jawed tightly in owning, stomps his wife's skull into the shape of his boot. The slit in her throat pulses blood into a halo. Their six-year-old son watches his mother congeal, imagines his father stuffed into an air duct lodged under the jail he crawled out from. His dreams, a lumpy duffel bag of oily rags and blue-black coveralls. His dreams, fists
full of his father's glistening black hair. His dreams, black as the prize backside, scurrying black bloodstool, black as cast, as soup, as cork spit, as skillet eye, furnace black, crouching, gliding, hissing, black as the good news, as the made-up thing I wear to meet you. I just have one more. Is that good? We're good for time? Begins with an epigraph from a writer, L. Marlake Gray. Savoring, the art is not to feed, but to taste, to take pleasure in the smallest increments the blade can deliver. Blood fetish. I love her face. I always want to suck it. She likes to kiss, nibble, and tease, but I just want to pull her face into my mouth. Her jaw's soft curve shadows my bite, and the plum-sweet meat of her ripens through its wax bloom. Its density suggests how else I might indulge myself. Last week, I sucked a bruise into the dimple of her left cheek. Meaty and so full of blood, she is a length of libidinous muscle, shrink-wrapped in skin. I trail my canines along her jutting ribcage ridge. So little fat. I scrape bone to mark my territory. Agreement is implicit. All words are equally dangerous. It is better not to speak. When accosted from behind, I imagine she turns fear to task, puts her mind to use filing carbon paper lists of next actions. Entering the theater of our play, she has learned to check for all available exits. Finding it to be a sealed box, she clenches, then unclenches her jaw. I watch her bend and contract. Tightening her core, she tunes the ear, focuses her gaze while I move silence in planks and slabs, loitering outside her field of vision. Today, we go further, led by the viscera and something else, an amoral drive, appetite. Nuclear appetite. Vibrant pleasure glistens between and beneath us. Lifting, it lifts. Sternum, abdomen, pelvis, thighs. Gripping my hand now, opening inside her, she inhales sharply. A short time later, pain bleeds out and saturates the air with sensation. A lulling white noise. Sustenance. I come up, push her head down hard, press her mouth against my sex to say, swallow. She is quick to find the precise angle. Her consistency prompts me. The electric force of the idea shatters the porcelain sky I imagine separates us. I dig in against her, through her yielding. My artful fingers shape her with their tips. The index, sharp enough to cut, matches inhalation. The room is awash with it. I lick the wound, a wing mid-stroke. 10 inches from right shoulder blade down to spine. Later, the scar, I imagine, her body will make real, healing itself into my grasp. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. First, I'd like to say thank you to Kaveh Canem for the invitation to come up this way and read, and also to the New School for hosting this event. And I will just get right into it here. As a poet, as you can imagine, many of us are in love with language. So this first poem I'm going to do is about a particular type of language which every English teacher and every mother in the English-speaking world have done their best to destroy, this particular construction of language. And so I decided to write a celebration of it, being from the South, and this is called Etymology of Ain't. Ain't used to be ain't, which comes from am not, as in I ain't you, but also is not, as in he ain't me. But also have not, as in I ain't been and don't want to be. Ain't is a state of that which is not. Ain't is a state in the American South. Ain't country. Ain't hip hop. Ain't nappy. Ain't cornrows. Ain't dreadlocks. Ain't ignores dress codes. No shoes, no socks. Ain't wears no drawers. Don't own any. Ain't never apologized for being. Ain't never been apologetic. Some say ain't no future in ain't, and ain't what it used to be. But wherever ain't is ain't. Ain't metaphysical. Is you is, or is you ain't. I ain't no haint. Ain't never been three-fifths of nothing. Ain't trying to be no more than I am. I is whole. Before I was born, I was all. Some placed ain't's tombstone between tis and twas. But ain't stands defiantly as don't and won't. Tar and feather me, burn me down. I ain't supposed to be here, but I is. So that was literal language, and this is about body language. So this particular poem is about a particular gesture which has become the signature of a particular segment of the population, black people, maybe black women in particular. And this is a celebration of this gesture, and it's called neck rollology. The most venomous snake in all of Africa is not the black mamba, though it does come from the depths of the Congo, pulled deep from the arch in her back, deep from hand on hip, winding and winding, wound up, whiplash, reptilian stance of one about to strike something. Make space. This is a cosmic conjure of ancient name like Zanzibar, Zambia, or Mozambique, which left the Greeks baffled by its geometry. Its improvised axis is jazz, falls between third and fourth dimensions, angular rotation, 720 degrees, rotational speed, 45 revolutions per minute. She spun it and spun it out of control, a neck roll. If I had wanted a double cheeseburger, I would have ordered a double cheeseburger. How the hell did you get double cheeseburger from two-piece snack? Thank you for humoring me. All right, so we're gonna ease on down into a little more seriousness here. This next piece is about the social implications of eating food in mixed company. And it's called The Dream Life of Dr. Bledsoe's Inner Pickaninny. Though he long ago resumed consuming pork, to this day he still will not eat fried chicken in front of white folk, octoroons, or even Negroes he needs to impress. Pondering entrees at a recent business lunch, craving the crunchy peppered crust. His glands moisten at the mere thought. But he fears the black skillet's neon grease will wildly distort the innate thickness of his lips. That sucking a drumstick dry will expose the enormous ivory bone stuck through his nose, warping his face, weighing him down in an ape-like walk, till his meticulous pinstriped life unravels like an unruly raffia skirt. Thus, when dessert time comes, he avoids sweet potato confections, pecan confrontations, and other denigrating delectables at all costs. Instead, his controlled fork picks like a good little boy through cool fruit salad, devouring apples, cherries, pears, and grapes, leaving a clean white plate, curiously bare, but for watermelon parts. When asked why he would not eat them, his reply, "Where would I hide the seeds?" So next, we're taking a trip to a botanical garden with a young African-American girl named Kenya. And this is called On a Field Trip to the Botanical Gardens, Kenya Gets a Lesson Not in the Lesson Plan. If she could, she would choose to be the color of yellow cosmos, French lavender, Texas paintbrush, or a Shasta daisy at the very least. Anything but the color of pots and kettles, which she is, which is when a chaperone, who also happens to be her mother, rebuts, "But Kenya, you are also the color of night, whose beauty cannot be contained by earth, nor expanding galaxies, wandering exquisitely as the thoughts of God, the color of infinity, if it had one, of eternity, if it ever paused to be measured. My daughter, you are the dream where God made Earth's first black volcanic beaches, whose undulating soot would birth cosmos and lavender and paintbrush, but whose first bloom was you. A hue so divine and heavy, no lesser flower could bear it." So Afiza was nice enough to introduce me with a quote from a publication that listed me as a African-American man with arms that stretch and reach and some business like that. So I'm going to give you the stretching and reaching part. So this next poem, I'm going to have to come off mic on this. Can everyone hear me okay in the back here?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, I have a big mouth. So this poem is about the unique history of African-American surnames. Surnames around the world often come from, say, a profession or a trade, like Smith or Butler or something or other. But when you come to the U.S., the last names that African Americans have a different way of coming to us, some of us. And so this poem is about where those names may have come from, and it's called The Genealogy of the Bird Family. My mama maiden name is Bird. Word is the name came from my great-great-great-granddaddy Junior, who used to catch the whoo Holy Ghost in the whoo cotton fields, spinning round and spreading his long black arms, wide like wings against the sky. They say, like that eagle who teach the angels how to fly. Hallelujah! But Big Mama Sandy said, that name come from great-great-great-great-auntie Boo, who used
work songs in the cane field with a soprano so high and sweet. She made the bluest hummingbirds dance and the greenest cane lean down and weep. Rivers of brown sugar. Sweet Jesus. But Big Uncle Tookie said, nah, nah, nah. That man come from great, 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 great grandpapa Adelphi, who on the 99th lash in the rice field finally fell to his knees before the overseer. He turned east toward Africa. Glory. Spread wings like a sankofa. Ah, oh, glory. Rose toward freedom and just flew away. Good God Almighty. That's what they say. But the truth of the matter is if bird come to us from a Carolina slave master, who folk in England ran this old country in that for generations came to be known the whole kingdom wide for their collection of exotic African birds, which never flew, but which they kept caged up inside.
Thank you. This next poem is very short. The title is actually probably longer than the poem. And for any of you who have been a minority in a majority situation, where you've sort of felt like the, I don't know, spokesperson for the entire group, you might identify with this. The irony that spawned this poem for me was being at a majority white institution and being the only black student in a black history class. So this is the token's final word on being asked to provide the black perspective in class. I speak for all black people when I say this. I do not speak for all black people. Thank you. Get that off my chest, okay. This next one is called Unmanifesto or Notes on Post-Postcolonialism, a Third Draft in CP Time. Yes, actually this is another poem about race. Maybe they all are. This time, my arrival ritual is metaphor. Next time, a primate. Then, a grass hut. Anything to show how natural I am. But hasn't my nature always been the problem? Am I being too prosaic? Is my directness unsettling? Try unsettling America. Humor me. Start with Hawaii and Alaska. Unmanifest these destinies. Undo the Sioux, the Iroquois, the Trail of Tears. Undo me, each shackle. Hint, my grinning is not a sign I'm into bondage. Undo amber waves of grain. I mean the song and the transcontinental train. Track upon track, each railroad tie back to free labor, Chinese, Chicano, and otherwise. Undo sands across deserts. Undo hours and centuries. But who can undo when bound by time's linear contract, which I am now breaking? Undo the starless black futures of your science fictions. Undo blacklessness on the Jetsons. Undo Third World. Undo unnamings of Kunta and Biafra. Undo uncivilized. No, I mean the concept. Undo these undoings. Navajo, Inca, Aztec, backtrack across the Atlantic to the Gold Coast. Let us critique you, weigh you, determine whether you're real art. I have two more? Good. Okay, two more. Okay, so these last two. This is a tribute to, as you know, the space shuttle program ended earlier this year, right? And so this is a tribute to the astronauts who gave their lives in the 2003 Space Shuttle Columbia disaster and in pursuit of science. And this is just called Of Ash and Dust. 1981. A black second lieutenant and his squadron crowd the Magnavox to watch Columbia, a virgin flight shining against cobalt blue, even confined in this 13-inch box, throttling atop a temple of flame to heaven. His pulse races as rocket boosters deploy, fall, parachute, just short of angels, back to Earth. And the spent external tank breaks away as planned, splashing where ocean praises sky, while the shuttle hurtles into the holiness of black, kissing the starry hem of God. The lieutenant's eyes wide as two black worlds. What a dream to live and die like this. 2003. Now his own trip into outer space. What a marvelous view. Every 90 minutes, the Great Wall of China, the Ganges River, the Sahara, and Death Valley are falling without falling, over and over, a new sun, a new moon, a new earth, 255 times before the final descent. An alarm. Boards and boards of flashing red lights. One, another, a cosmic wildfire. Warning, warning, and sensors and panic. Bulging of eyes and smashing of panels. Houston, Houston, the whole cabin's quaking. Stars and stripes and shockwaves and plasma. I can't feel my hands and cursing and praying in Hebrew and Hindi. This can't be happening. My daughters are waiting. The stars are behind us. Just 15 minutes from kebabs and kugel. From sand between toes, from Yol's bar mitzvah. Mayday, mayday, if you're there, Jesus, answer. Depressurization, circuitry burning. I feel Jimi Hendrix. See Yahweh, I'm kosher. I pray that my ashes are blown to the ocean. We've lost all power. The temperature's rising. Halos of fuel. The whole sky is splitting. I will die clutching this relic from Auschwitz. The light is so blinding. My God, California. Clutching and trembling and thunder and lightning. A great flash of flame till hearts breaking. So this final poem I'm going to do, and thank you all, thank you all. You've been a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful audience. This final poem, in this country, black men often get a bad rap, and there is a black man that really did write by me. And so I want to do something to celebrate him. You know, that poem was about, you know, in the blink of an eye, your loved ones can be taken away from you. And, you know, this is a black man who is still alive, my father. And I just want to do a tribute to him, and this is called Things My Father Gave Me, Which I Never Asked For. Life, a home plate, a backyard with a pitching mound, a split finger fastball, a slider, a curve, how to break in a glove, when to slide head first, a family name to uphold, open arms, time, a huffy bike, how to crack pecans, a sandbox, how to piss, how to be a rock, when to till the earth, how to make a fist, when to fight, when to smile, how to trap a rabbit, how to catch a liar, how to speak when white people are present, how to talk when white folk ain't. The difference between a flat head, a Phillips head, and a hard head. A roof over my head. Room to grow. How to shoot a free throw. When to call a foul. How to drive. A high top fade. How to ask out a lady. How to let her be a woman. How to use a level. How to keep your cool. When to be cool. Cool. A pimp stroll. How to smoke out wasps. Where to get good fish. Funk and Wagnalls. When to ask for help. When to give it. How to speak up. A love of brown. Tarbleton. How to mow the lawn. To hammer. To saw. How to change a tire. When to change the oil. How to handle change. How to tie a tie. How to buy a suit. How to earn an honest dollar. How to lead. How to follow. How to read the spread. When to swallow your pride. How to raise a fence. How to use a knife for a pencil sharpener. When to shoot a gun. How to shake a man's hand. How to look him in the eye. A thirst to learn. A bookcase. Muscadines. Nights to dream. Dream books. Reasons to cry. Dark skin. Strong teeth. Full lips. Blood. Two brothers. How to care for elders. How to honor them. How to admit when you're wrong. How to apologize before the funeral. How to love. Yes. And how to always, always, always come home.
Thank you.
I'm going to flip around a little bit. Old, new, brand new, older. Speaking of token, and speaking of post-black, let me read, mostly to uncover the reality of the myth of post-blackness. Mostly to uncover the reality of the myth of post-blackness. Oh, there's babies in here. Y'all might want to cover your ears. Sorry. He left me wounded in a room full of artists, and none of them had black eyes. One had brown eyes, but she wouldn't speak up. She looked at me forgivingly, paralyzed. Some of them saw me, but not really. One did, but he only wanted to fuck. If only I could stop bleeding. His eyes were as open blue as sky, and I could go, but I know there would be an ending I didn't choose. My brain moved faster and faster. They saw me tremble and not so much as a white tissue. I could kneel down and pry at the floorboards with a scream and broken fingers, and they would just keep talking like I was a ghost or a shadow. Then go to the beer garden and chug cheap pints. Then take long walks in the woods conversing about the nature of art and objective disappearance. Then spend a year painting in Uzbekistan wearing thin shirts with holes in them and never new shoes. They could chew gum loud and starve or fish and get fat and take shitty photographs of moonlight in trailer parks and above urban nightlife. This is how it begins and happens and ends, drawing right past me as if I am the one keeping still. So I will read pieces of the title poem. It's a long poem in the new book, which I just saw today. Thank you, Crystal, for bringing all these down. Black Peculiar Energy Complex. Marked upon is to relational dark as diabetic is to aesthetics. Dear puppets, I want to make you say things I cannot, but I don't want your mouths to move. Stitched shut is to slipshod as material is to immovable. Dear buttons, I cannot sew you on properly without my favorite needle. Wait just a moment while I dig it out. Dysphoria is to metaphysical toilets as burned tendons are to drunken interest. Dear master, I am running away from you now. alluring figures are to Derridian abundance is to interference. Dear invincible reference point, let's say we take a certain counterpoint out of the picture, the moment of strangulation, perhaps. If the peculiar energy becomes complex, just call it black. Objectified is to observe as karma is to evolutionary stagnation. Dear interference, I have a habit of sitting too close to the television. When I look, I'm not really looking. I eat the terrible stories. Finality is to compassion as chronic abandonment is to foresee. Dear authority, the wilder seasons in North Carolina make the green that much more precious and terrifying. Wait, it's Ella, Tisket, Tisket. I will do all the naming. Entitlement is to against mercy, as far, far beyond is to linked consequence. Dear fruit, I chose not to eat you today. You looked so delicious, I did not think I deserved to strip off your skin with my teeth and let your tart, sticky liquor drip down my throat, even though I was both hungry and thirsty. I believe there's beauty in an untouched thing. I could have devoured you, but didn't. I am not a very good animal. I talk too much. So let's move to some old poems that I'm trying to put into a new manuscript, or an old new manuscript. Maybe just one. It's called White Teeth. Ask a woman who has had, oh my God, there's babies in here. I can't read this one. I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to skip that one. It's a little too much. Let's read some older ones. Sorry, I have an 11-year-old. I can't live. All right. Okay, this is from Conduit. Four suggestions. One, indifference. You could drift off. A downward suspicion making surreptitious curves. You, I am not willing, lost a figure of instance yesterday. Figured secretly I declined to go further than this, that I would have had to come at a time different, more unlocked than. But this is where I stop and start no more. This stance, which is no mechanical habit, a reflex stoked irregularly into the shape of a conquered spine. Not willing I have yet conquered this, earned this particular scrutiny, but this is where I stop and start no more. Two, demarcation, as in to isolate. I'll not couple overlook with hints at catastrophe. And how will you arrive, averted or otherwise, wearing four heliotrope dresses in a single afternoon? Wild shifts of sunlight, cold, and night, four heliotrope dresses, a single afternoon, I wear whole and all. I have counted the thousand thirsty buds burrowed in the black bulk of your loosened hair. This is from Ways to Unsettle the Flesh. Remote preparations. Invent the lives behind each kempt landscape, flowering like graves on a hillside, ideals impossible to finger. False premonitions, stunned still instants, each one the chasm of a furious kiss. And voice is a brushful of red ochre. Warm, untidy pitch, worth the joy in keeping. In unmaking, distance in the body is made whole. Transformed from void to dwelling place, its maze of history as twisting as that of an olive tree, its grooved flank, firm leaves leaving traces of shadow, the love it must have taken not to let it be cut down, the uncharted resilience. And one more from Conduit, suspension tactics. Esperalo. Your God was a God that waited. Nestled in the eternal unclaimed, praised for attending the isolado, a God you breathed a certain love into. Denied the time days of your life, listen. He swore only to a combination of things, secret affiliations, scotoma, the color black, the color blue. Traga el pantano. Every day see yourself without. Desire unmoored from its greedy tether, shrinking, lovely, each shamed part of you that never surrenders. Wait for signs of return. Esperalo al lado de las estrellas envenenadas. Find a way to dream him out of unconscious manipulations, to yield instead a prized emblem, sans rules and measures, torn from the plush altar of someone else's future god, a decadent totem poised for the stirring of small miracles. Todos los días queda en la espera. An expert in such things, you don't believe in escape. Take witness. Stand on a bed of cloud, a sky of this. Engage in accidental acts of rapture. Seize each polluted hour, allotropic, ruthless. We do not guess how you have paid. So I'm going to go back to Black Peculiar and read a little bit from the middle section, which is called Animus. And if you know what an animus is, it's like the external ego thing. And I was making up this story. And so this he is like the animus he. It's not necessarily me that the animus belongs to, but mostly to uncover the reality of my destructive hunger. He gave me nothing to eat but photographs of other people eating meat, cooked and raw, half gone and about to be sliced. In the photographs, the people looked relaxed and not very hungry. But first, they were killing the animals with their careful machines. This was before clumsy hands came to the collective mauling, and before the children danced carefully in their ironed clothes at their little table. It all looked delicious, the shiny weapons and thick spats of flesh and slavering mouths and families. He did this in order that I might see how feeding is done. Mostly to uncover the reality of my closed fist, he pressed needles between my fingers to see if I would bleed, and I did. Bled through the tiny pricks, tiny red dots that didn't spill, torn tracts of skin, needle hitting bone, prick, prick, prick. Fingernails made crescents deep in the supple yellow mount of my palms. I kept moving, near vine, wavering palm trees bent toward dirty street stops but didn't touch. People walked on stars and spat gum, phlegm, flashed new tattoos and private piercings, held hands. Some held needles in their arms or a memory. I pressed tighter, closed my mouth around my teeth. My closed hands made two needled fists. They bled from their infant pores. I couldn't feed them, couldn't stroke them, couldn't give them up. Mostly to uncover the reality of my inferior mothering, he orphaned me. I had no one to smother me into silence. No weary arms to fall into or out of. No lap to lay across where leather and buckles lash me. No green twigs to sting a deeper color into my flesh. No eyes to follow me into the dark where I could starve and cry, I hate you, I hate you. I even gave birth to an orphan. I smothered him into silence. I dropped him on his beautiful head when he let go of my breast. I let him be laughed at, and I let him look at me as I did nothing. I left him in the woods, and I left him for dead. Still, he doesn't hate me, no matter how many times I snap him in two. Mostly to uncover the reality of my soothing brand of sickness, I called a dangerous man my husband, and something inside me loved it. Loved the way each day he killed me a little more, killed himself a little more. There were ways of believing everything he said. Sometimes it meant folding my thoughts into tight squares with sharp edges that nicked my tongue as I held them underneath. Sometimes it meant hiding parts of myself in pissy alleyways and abandoned parking lots where they got slept on and rained on, pushed around in shopping carts or made a doorway on some tired body's flimsy house. I ended up a vagina with half a heart and no deep breaths. He never wanted or missed me, but he wanted to. His brutal attachment burning the inside of me like an etching, toxic and harsh in its carefully planned beauty. I almost believed I could take it. One day I thought I couldn't fight anymore, and then a sudden shift. I hustled a latticework of craving between blows. I unlocked my chorus of archetypal women from their chains. They rubbed their raw wrists with aloe and set to work. Mostly to uncover the reality of my imperative need to truly understand the nature of all animal behavior, he told me a story. In the story, one dog snarls at another. The snarling, scruffy dog has one blue eye, one brown eye, and a chewed-off tail. It is lean, and its tongue is muddy. It licks dirt. It eyeballs and stalks the other dog, hanging that tongue over that dog's head. The other dog leans into the pant. It's a small dog, fluffy and well-loved. Before opening his mouth to the fluffy dog's head, the scruffy dog goes completely silent. The fluffy dog licks the muddy tongue. A pale man in a black suit leans toward the scruffy dog, points at the fluffy one, says, "Go ahead, boy. Go on. Get your snack." Okay. Let's see if I can pick out one of these. It's not too vulgar. When I lived in Compton, teenage boys liked to lean on the hood of my father's Porsche. Black Levi's slung below their muscled waists, crisp white t-shirts with tanks underneath, Jerry curls oiling the backs of their yokes. They stayed put when my father, dressed in Armani for his city job, marched down the stairs rattling his keys. They turned up their boombox, NWA's hard on beats masking the clip, clip, clip of Ferragamo loafers on pavement. My father moved toward them, pointing his manicured finger at the corner of Sloan and Compton as dope man heralds his arrival. He gestured wildly at their sluggish bodies, and a sudden high pitch meant his voice was breaking. When they slid from the hood of his prized German silver, my father shook his head, slammed the door as he plunged into the driver's seat, gunned the engine, threatened to run them over. But the boys refused to stumble. In their unlaced Cortez sneakers, they simply strolled to the right, undivided, boombox still blasting from their shoulders as if they knew where he was headed and saw no reason to split themselves apart. And I will close with Thick as Pins. As kids, I swear we lived for hairpins, bobby pins. Sometimes we kept them in our pockets. We had little combs and endlessly styled our hair, Barbie's hair. Sometimes the pins ended in strange configurations, semi-paper clips, mini Barbie knives, the rounded tips bitten off and made razors. Sometimes Barbie got so mad at Ken, she'd have to cut him. Of course, we didn't call them by those names. Our Barbies were Mahogany, June Blackout, Badass Grandma Cecil. Now the withering games between us, all but one, a mother, what we offer each other is more than comfort. We expect a wounding. We marvel at the needle of love. Armed with those pins, we found plenty to do. It's not important what we found. We were gifted. Thank you.
All right, everyone, thank you for coming. There's wine in the back and books in the back as well. Buy and get them signed. Thank you.